I am Sridhar, so I basically work on telecom regulation policy, but as I have told you before, so I have started looking at data protection and privacy issues as it is closely related to telecom. So this particular session, we will try to give you some background about data protection, privacy, you know, how to understand the issues surrounding privacy, how does it affect, you know, for example, the privacy of individuals, firms, organizations, and what are the regulatory mechanisms that should be in place. And we'll also take some examples from the existing acts and policies and what they cover. I mean, that's basically the succinct of, you know, 1.5 hour lecture. So if you have any questions, please stop me at any point of time. So the context is that suddenly data protection and privacy has become a big issue, right? I mean, we are known for giving private information at ease with our neighbors, and whenever we go in the train, we are very, very happy to divulge about our private information. But suddenly it has become a big issue, right? And Supreme Court is looking at it, and this is the most important. National Law School of India University is here, right? So why is it becoming a big important issue? So we need to understand that in everyday life we use technologies, right? I mean, that's the whole theme of this particular winter school. And so we deal with Facebook, we deal with LinkedIn, we use mobile, we use Wi-Fi hotspots for connecting to the internet, we do Google search, right? And we buy things at Amazon, we book cabs through Ola Cab. All these information suddenly is digital, and therefore it is possible to collect all these information and then use it for whatever purpose it is intended for or non-intended for. Right? And therefore, suddenly after the digitization has come in place, the privacy and data protection has become a very, really very important issue because it surrounds our everyday life. So I am being surveilled, right? So everywhere you are being surveilled, and that information can be used for any purposes. And therefore, it's becoming very important in today's context. And these technologies are intrinsically intrusive in nature. Right? Even if you don't know, it is being intruded upon. Your information is being intruded upon at any point of time. Right? So it is very, very intrusive in nature. So, for example, I was just looking for a speaker for my Mobile Evindia event, which I normally conduct in the first week of January. And I was looking for Rakesh, at the CEO, I mean, who is in charge of networks, homes at Airtel. And suddenly LinkedIn gives me a job. Right? So you can take this particular job in Airtel. So you can see this profile. I have been matched with a job in Airtel, right? So because of my LinkedIn profile and the search that I did, this information is being used for projecting something which I may or may not be interested in, right? So this is how information is being collated, organized, and analyzed, and then it is posted for your use, consumption. So it's very intrusive in nature. So take a look at this cartoon, right? So for example, if ever you want to snoop on someone's life, you better be an app developer. If you are an app developer, you can get all the information that you want on your app, right? Where this guy has gone, what pages that he has visited, which places he has gone, right? All this information is available to you if you just develop a mobile app and put it on that particular person's mobile phone, right? So it is very, very easy. Not only that the information has become digital, but it's become easier for us to snoop, right? It's easier for us to collect information. So hence the context, right? But the important thing is that we still have tremendous confusion about privacy. Nobody knows exactly what privacy means. If you ask, so for example, sir, what does privacy mean to you? What does privacy mean to you?
Privacy depends on subject to definition.
Correct. That's the most important point. Yeah.
Something is not provided from others person, other people. Only the thing is which data I would like to share with others.
Acha. So
it is public data.
Okay.
The data which I do not want to share. If it is being shared, it means it is not something.
Okay. So what you are saying is I will share some information. The information that I don't want to share, if it is shared, then it is a violation of privacy. What about you? What's the definition of privacy that you can give?
Is the ability to safeguard information, my interests, things that pertain, that are of a personal nature. My ability to safeguard and protect.
Okay. So, if you are not able to safeguard the information that is of interest to you, then it means it's a violation of privacy. That's what you're saying.
That's of a personal nature, yes.
That's of personal nature. If you are not able to protect it, but somebody intrudes on it, then it is a violation of privacy. So, what about you? What's the definition of privacy that you can give?
Yeah, I would say if someone's using my information without my knowledge.
Somebody is using without your knowledge. You are not. So, it is very similar to her, but is it different from what he is saying? Okay. Shushravya, what's your definition of privacy?
So, something that should not be used without your knowledge.
Without your knowledge. So, similar to what? What about you, sir?
Same.
Without my. So, we are congruent.
Without my intention, anything information.
Huh. So, without your consent, if the information is shared, then it is a violation of privacy.
Or even collecting of my information from third party.
Good point. So, collecting of information from third party without your knowledge or with your knowledge?
Without
your knowledge, then it is a violation of privacy. Is there any other definition of privacy that you can give?
Following or tracking my actions.
Without your knowledge or with your knowledge?
With
private information or public information? For example, you have come here and you might have posted it in your LinkedIn. If somebody follows that, is that violation of privacy? Is it violation of privacy?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. What about you?
If my privacy is being intruded.
What is that? That is intrusion means. So, for example, we are, NPTEL is recording this. Is this violation of privacy?
No, they have taken my consent.
They have taken. So, if they, as long as they have taken for your consent, then it is not a violation of privacy.
Yes.
Okay.
And how it is used, why it is used, where it is used.
Okay. So, suppose, for example, NPTEL takes this information, use it for purposes other than education. Is it violation of privacy?
Yes.
Obvious.
Possible. Okay. So, I think it is, I'll just skip this one. So, it's very, very important to understand a taxonomy of privacy. Otherwise, we'll just go into loops and then we'll not be able to figure out, how to punish a particular violation of privacy. For example, if it is, if the information is shared without my knowledge, is it a greater crime compared to, for example, intruding into my personal domain, breaking my security and taking that information away? Right? So, there are various degrees of violation of privacy, and only if you understand the taxonomy of the privacy that we will be able to have a clear understanding. Right? And so, this particular, I like this framework, it has been formulated in 2007 by this guy called Solovo. It's been, I have given the references, you can look at it, University of Pennsylvania Law Review. So, what this basically does is, I'll give you some examples later on. So, information gets collected, processed, disseminated, and so on. At each stage, there can be violation of privacy, right? And it can take different dimensions, depending upon which part of the cycle that we are in, right? So, for example, in the case of information collection, it can be surveillance. For example, there can be a surveillance camera, which can be mounted in your private home or in a public place, such a retail space, which may be monitoring you all the time, and then which may be collecting information, right? Now, we need to see whether it is a public space, private space, it's covert or overt. All these dimensions we have to look at it before deciding whether there is any violation or not. Suppose, for example, CCTV surveillance is here. All retail stores now have that, right? Now, they have publicly posted it, right? Now, it is overt. They have already told you the CCTV camera is there, visible for you. And it's a public place. It's a retail store. All people come here, right? And so, this is very different invasion of privacy compared to, for example, that it is a overt CCTV camera which is surveilling you in a public place, right? Will you do something which you won't do normally? Will you do that? Will you do the same thing that you have done in your private, unsurveilled place in a public surveilled place? You will not do that because there is someone who is monitoring, So you'll be careful. Right? So, we need to look at all these dimensions, before deciding whether there is invasion of privacy, and if there is an information privacy, what degree that it is. Right? So, so you have a data subject and you go through all these processes, and then individuals go through this process, businesses go through the process, government goes through these processes, and there can be violation at different levels. So, this is exactly what we are trying to sort of figure out, right? It is very, in 1.5 hours, it's very difficult to go through each and everything in detail, but I will just go through some examples and then see how, for example, it fits into the taxonomy. And then it is very easy for us to figure out whether it is a violation, how serious is the violation, what is the punishment that we need to give, is there any act which governs this particular violation, and so on and so on, right? Okay. So, the first important aspect which we normally don't associate with, for example, privacy, is aggregation. What is aggregation? See, if you tell the Aadhaar number, right, Aadhaar number is 12-digit Aadhaar number, is it a random number? Is it a random number or not? Or once you say the number, you can say that, oh, it is Professor Sridhar at IIIB and all. Can you say that? You cannot say that. No, it's a random number, right? So just I will give you my number, nobody will be able to associate anything with that particular Aadhaar number. It's a randomly generated number. But if you associate that number with name, with address, with mobile number, right, with your Google password, Facebook password, or Facebook, login ID, and so on, then what will you get? Will you be able to say that it is Professor Sridhar at IIIB? You will be able to say. And this is exactly.
And what he is purchasing on Amazon.
So you will find out so many things about me as long as I divulge you certain other information which can be collated with my Aadhaar ID, right? This process is known as aggregation, right? So for example, your Aadhaar number by itself does not cause any privacy problem. If somebody steals my Aadhaar number, what can they do with it? They can't do anything with that, right? However, if you aggregate it with other data, then it becomes very powerful, right? Then I can profile that particular person. So aggregation is a very serious offense. In fact, we don't know, right? At this point of time, you did not even say that aggregation is a problem, right? So aggregation is a very serious problem, and you can use aggregation in many ways, right? So for example, Google does that, right? Google knows your personal ID, and it knows your browsing pattern, and therefore it is able to collect all these things and then come up with a profile. Oh, this guy is interested in telecom, therefore let me throw some advertisements relating to telecom. LinkedIn did that, right? So this aggregation, is it violation of privacy? Is it violation of privacy? How serious is it? We don't know the answer, right? At this point of time, we don't have a clear-cut answer, right? But aggregation is the biggest problem in information technology. And it is easy for us, for technology companies, to aggregate data, right? And to put some kind of using algorithms that you discussed in the last session, it's possible to profile a particular person, right? So, for example, this is a classic case, right? There is something called as Facebook meme, which came around two years back. They give you memes, right? 10 concerts they will give you, right? And you rate them, whether you like it or not like it. And finally, there will be a question which says that, you know, tell me the last concert that you went that you really liked, okay? Then you will tell the name. They will collect this information, right? And then they have your Facebook, login ID and so on and so on. They will be able to, using this, they were able to profile, for example, whether a person who has answered this 10 meme concert question is a male or a female, black or white, which country he had come from, India or Pakistan or US or Russia, right? After that, they will be able to show advertisements which are relating to the profile of that particular person. Simple 10 questions. They aggregate it, right? And then make a profile out of it. And using that profile, they will be able to target. Why companies do that? Companies might do it for its own personal purposes, right? They will be able to sell advertisements, they'll be able to rein in revenue and things like that. But is it a violation of privacy? Is this violation of privacy? 10 meme concert question. They didn't ask you anything, right? They asked you to log in through Facebook, right? And they had this 10 questions that you answered, and they are able to push advertisement which they have been able to successfully profile you, right? Your gender, your ethnic background, whether you are a Carnatic classical music lover or film songs, you like film songs, right? You like Hindi film songs or Tamil films or Kannada films. They are able to do all those things using that 10 questions that you have answered, right? Is this violation of privacy? In what degree, in a scale of 1 to 10, how do you rate this as a serious violation? 1 to 10, 1 being low, 10 being high. 1. 1?
7. because they are aggregating without my knowledge.
And also they're probably monetizing it, right?
Yeah, that's the business model, right? You're able to do Google search free only because of advertisements. Otherwise, each search will cost you like 10 rupees. Will not be able to do Google search, no? Google search is free. Why is it free? Because they have aggregated information and use advertisements for their monetization model, right? Now, you can always ask this question, right? Did they ask me before aggregating? You might have put a tick mark on somewhere in Google, Facebook, long time back, right? That I agree to all the conditions, right?
Most of the terms and conditions, they say that we might change the terms and conditions anytime they want.
Anytime they want.
Even when you sign, that particular clause might not have been there, they can insert it later as well.
Right. Okay. No, so we are evolving. At any point of time, new business models are emerging around aggregated data, right? And we know that there is a violation, right? How serious is a violation depending upon this particular context, right? So this is one of the important problems in privacy, right? Aggregation. So for example, why are people worried about Aadhaar linking? Suppose for example, I link my Aadhaar card, which is a random number, right? To, for example, my PAN card, to, for example, my mobile number. Is it possible that using that one identity called Aadhaar number, they will be able to collect all these different information to which I have linked and create a profile and say that, oh, this guy is not paying income tax, right? Or this guy is fooling income tax department. Or this guy is, he went to, for example, Meghalaya in October of 2017, 23rd of October. Will they be able to do that? Possible. If your Aadhaar number is linked to mobile number knows where you are and therefore they will be able to track you, right? Now the question is it good or bad, right? Is it good or bad? Is this aggregation of information good or bad? See, everything has good, the positive side and the negative side, right? And then there has to be some trade-off. So is aggregation good? Suppose, for example, in the 10 meme concert question, I get an advertisement and I get a coupon, right? Which gives me 250 rupees off on my next ticket, right, to a concert. It's good for me, right? Otherwise, I would not have found out. Now I have got it, right? What about the bad thing? It is quite possible that I might be profiled and I might, you know, can be used for some other purposes, right? So there are trade-offs, right? And so we'll discuss about information goods as a market later on. So this gives us some framework, you know. For example, aggregate information, if it is taken without my consent, it's not a very serious violation of privacy, but it is there, you know, between 1 and 5, something like that, I can put a number to it, right? The second important aspect of information privacy is secondary use. This is a gross violation, I would say. What is secondary use? You collect information for one purpose, right? But I use it for entirely different purpose without even concern. You know, getting a consent from you, right? So, it is possible that you might link your Aadhaar card to your bank account, right? The primary intention being that, you know, every cash transaction should be tracked and, you know, they should be accountable and things like that. So, we should not have, bank accounts without a specific personality associated with it. So there has to be a linkage and so on. But if it is used for some other purposes, then it can be called as a secondary use. And secondary use is a serious violation, right? Because you're not taking the individual's consent. There is absolute information asymmetry between me and Google, right? Google knows my search pattern, but what Google is going to do with it is absolutely unknown to me, right? There is absolute information asymmetry. So that information asymmetry is being used by the data capture person, right? It can be easily monetized, right? It can be leveraged. It can be intruded upon. I don't have any way of knowing because I don't know exactly how the data collector is going to use that information for, right? And therefore, secondary use is the biggest concern. So in a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate secondary use as a serious violation of privacy? 10. Okay. So this cartoon gives it all, right? Last owner of this particular information set was used only for shopping, but you can use it for something else. So the secondary information can be traded. The primary data collector, for example, Google, may not be using the data, but if it sells the data to someone else, say for example insurance company, that insurance company might be able to use the information that Google has provided in order to profile me, sick person, healthy person, rich, poor, whatever it is, right? So the secondary use not only exists between the data object and the immediate data collector, the primary data collector, but it can actually propagate, right? That is one of the important aspects of secondary use, and it is can cause serious violation because you really don't know who is using it, because that chain of secondary data collectors is unknown to you, right? And there is absolutely information asymmetry between the data object and the data collector. So this is a serious problem, and people take notice of it. You know, for example, WhatsApp. We all use WhatsApp, and WhatsApp was bought by Facebook last year, and now Facebook is part of WhatsApp, right? What is it that WhatsApp collects that Facebook does not have? WhatsApp collects some information, Facebook collects some information. What is it that WhatsApp has that Facebook does not have? Number, your number. Facebook does not need number, but WhatsApp requires your mobile number, right? And therefore, WhatsApp knows, using your mobile identity, your GPS location, the places where you have visited, your conversation that you have posted, all those things are known to WhatsApp. That's not known to Facebook.
No, so the friends' contacts.
Friends' contacts, everything, right? Friends' phone number, everything it knows, right? Facebook does not know, does not have any information about mobile numbers, right? Telephone numbers is not known to Facebook. It only goes by Facebook login ID. However, Facebook has bought WhatsApp, and therefore you don't know exactly what's happening with the information that is collected by WhatsApp, right? So it's quite possible that WhatsApp can generously hand over everything to Facebook, and Facebook, with Facebook information, can profile you much, much better because it knows much more granular information about you, right? So it was taken a note of by Supreme Court, right? So Supreme Court is still cases in progress. They said that, you know, what is the deal between WhatsApp and Facebook, right? Can WhatsApp share all the information to Facebook, right? Because WhatsApp, when you are signing up for WhatsApp, I am not signing up for Facebook. It's quite possible that WhatsApp is owned by Facebook, right? But when I am doing WhatsApp, I am only contracting with WhatsApp as a service provider, right? And so, for example, WhatsApp has created this peer-to-peer private conversation. So if I make a conversation to you on WhatsApp, it is guaranteed that it is encrypted, right? Using peer-to-peer without any central key, and therefore it is not possible even for WhatsApp to crack it, right? That's the guaranteed encryption protocol that WhatsApp gives for communication between peers or in groups, right? But I am not saying that WhatsApp can share the information to Facebook so that Facebook can profile me based upon my telephone number, right? And this is secondary use. This is exactly secondary use, right? So you collect information for your primary purpose, but it is shared with someone else as a secondary service provider, right? So Supreme Court has taken note of it, and the case is in progress. WhatsApp has been asked to explain what is the information that it is sharing with Facebook, right? So we are conscious of it, right? On the other hand, the US, under the chairmanship of Ajit Pai, who is the Federal Communication Commission chairman, has reversed track. In the recent ruling, what they have said is that, you know, internet companies like Facebook, Google, they all collect information, they all use it for whatever purpose they want, right? The telecommunication companies like Vodafone, Airtel, right? They are all bounded by regulation. They were not able to collect information that they wanted for their own use. Let us free that one also, right? So Ajit Pai said that telecom companies can actually collect information. They can sell it to the secondary or third, you know, tertiary service providers without getting the user's consent. It's a major overruling of the previous administration's protection bills, right? So countries are taking sides. Now, is secondary use good or bad? Suppose, for example, we all know that Google does the secondary use beautifully, right? That's one of the reasons why Google search is free. The reason why search is free is that because of your organic search pattern, you get the advertisements which are targeted to you, right? They know what you want, and therefore they are so that information is passed on to the advertiser. Advertiser posts the advertisement, and you click through it. Google earns revenue, and you also get coupon. So secondary use has some benefit, looks like, right? But is it okay to have secondary use? Google has not explicitly asked you before posting the advertisement, oh, do you want this advertisement to be posted? Does it ask you anytime? It doesn't.
But we can give feedback on each and every ad.
Okay. Opt out, right? All the policies that we have are all opt-in. I mean, this is basically, these are all opt-out policies. By default, you are opted in. Okay. By default, you agree to the terms and conditions. You don't even read it because it's so complicated. It's not user friendly, right? So we can only opt out. For example, you know that there is something called as do not call registry. I mean, if you keep on getting SMS, you know, your mobile number has been leaked by the telcos to all the service providers around the world. They keep on sending you SMS, insurance agents call, right? Opt out policy, right? By default, I am opted in. If I want to opt out, then I have to put my name in the do not call register. Most of the time it doesn't work, but if it works, then you will not get that SMS from that particular company, right? So the question is, should we have opt-in as a policy, right? So before secondary use, I have to explicitly opt-in. Otherwise, I should not be by default opted in. And that's a policy question, right? It's a policy question. So as of now, most of the secondary use survives because we have, in most of the cases, opt-out policy. Unless you explicitly opt out, by default, you are actually consenting to secondary use of that information. Is that correct? So how do you rate it now in a scale of 1 to 10? On a 10? 10. 7. Okay.
If it is not, I mean, I have read some articles that if you are linking Aadhaar, there is associating with some kind of crimes, it can be framed or something. Except this clause, except this kind of cases, I think for everything, this is an open market, so why my data should not be
used?
Yeah.
Okay, so there is a clause, okay, suppose say Google says that, you know, if you divulge this information, I will give you a coupon worth 250 rupees, okay, then I opt in to get this advertisement, get the 250 rupees coupon, then it is okay, then it is not a violation of privacy, no?
It's
by consent, yeah. So as long as there is consent, there is no violation of privacy, okay, Which one?
They can use it for secondary use.
The important thing is consent you give based upon what is the purpose behind which the secondary user is going to use it. But as we have discussed before, there is absolute information asymmetry between you and the service provider, right? Service provider might say something, but he can use it for some other thing. You know, it is very difficult to find out whether my consent is for this purpose or for that purpose. It's very ambiguous, right? One of the ways by which we can surmount this problem is using opt-in instead of opt-out. That's possible scenario, right? So this is a case of secondary use, and is important.